Hey team, and welcome to the video version of the Funnily Enough podcast. This is where you get the raw, unedited version of the interviews that we do on the show. If you're more of an audio person, then head over to Apple Podcasts or any of the platforms that you like that supports podcasting, and you can listen to the fully edited thing there with intros, outros, and all the fun little jingles. However, if you're more of a video person, then that is coming right up. Anne Handley, welcome to the show. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you for having me.
It's an absolute pleasure to have you. I feel it's been too long since we've actually had a proper chat. I know we bumped into each other briefly at Social Media Marketing World, but...
Yeah, that was kind of a drive-by though. So yeah, that was in what, March or April, something like that, February?
Yeah, March.
Yeah. And before that, I think it was probably Content Marketing Academy, right? That's CMA Live, probably.
Edinburgh, yeah.
Too long. RIP to CMA Live, but yeah.
Rest in peace. Pray for CMA.
When
do you go?
I didn't mean to hijack that your questioning, but I just have to say that my first memory of you, I should say, is the very first CMA Live. So that would have been, 2015, 16, something like that? Yeah. And you created your own Snapchat filter. Do you remember that? This is before Instagram stories. And you created your own Instagram filter that said something like, you know, say, or take a selfie with Gavin, right? Something like that. And I thought to myself, this guy is genius. You know, he has it all going on. So I'm really happy to talk to you today and just to watch you and your career. It's been amazing. So
I appreciate that. I appreciate
you're a rock star.
Oh, Anne, you're making me blush. Amazing. Well, because we've got a short time together, let's get straight to the serious questions then, shall we? We both have King Charles Cavaliers. We're both big fans. They're just the best, aren't they? Mm-hmm. But I want to know, what's the weirdest thing that you have bought, Abby? Like outfit or toy or... Because I feel like Cavalier owners, we're pretty dedicated dog owners.
Well, I think... You know, Abby doesn't wear clothes. She's just not that kind of gal. I mean, I've tried, but she just doesn't. She doesn't like sweaters. She doesn't like raincoats. She doesn't like rain. So anything that I've bought her that would be considered maybe a little bit indulgent like that doesn't fly with her. So what's the point of making her unhappy?
Fair.
My biggest thing that I buy her on a regular basis, which some people think is weird, but I think is completely normal because she's a Cavalier King Charles Spaniel. She's 15 years old. She's got one eye. She's deaf and she has a heart condition. So what does that mean? That means that this dog is going to live forever because she's just thriving. She's living her best life now, even at 15 with all of those complications. So all that to say, the fact that every week I buy her fresh meat, fresh vegetables, and I cook for her. And everybody in my life who has witnessed this thinks it's the weirdest thing ever because, you know, dogs should eat kibble or canned food or something that's prepared by a manufacturer in a kitchen somewhere, but not this gal. And that's why she's 15 and that's why she's thriving. So
I love that because I feel like dogs, although we pretend or well, not pretend, but we all love dogs, but then we just feed them this crap.
Yeah.
And then we expect, or like, we wouldn't eat dry, crappy food. So why do we expect the dogs to?
Yeah. And she loves it. She's, you know, like I said, she was 15 in May. We had a quinceañera, a 15 year birthday party for her. And she's doing really, really well. And for a small dog to be that age and just still up for walks every day, she dances around for her food. She just, you know, whatever. So it makes her happy. It makes me happy.
She's definitely one of my favorite people to follow on Instagram stories. Yeah. Every time I see her, I'm like, Lauren, look at this.
Yeah. She's a supermodel. Let's just call it.
Yeah. I love it. Amazing. So moving from Cavaliers then to what you're probably known best for, and other than being a super dog mum, is your writing. And one of the things that I love about what you talk about is the ugly first draft. And I feel like as business owners, so the people listening probably do a bit of writing, They probably blog because they've been told they should blog. But chances are they're probably doing what I certainly still do to an extent, I've got to be honest, is seek that perfection in writing. But when you talk about writing, you often talk about just write something ugly and then we can fix it later on. So how ugly is the ugly first draft for you? Like, are we talking just hammer down anything that comes to your head? When you're writing a blog for the first time, or when you're telling business owners to write a blog for the first time, what does that look like for them?
So in terms of what it looks like for everybody, it can look like a number of things. I talk about writing your ugly first draft as a kind of grocery list, only instead of writing, you know, chicken for Abby and squash for Abby, instead of that, just write your main key points that you want to make in anything you're writing. And this includes a blog post, it includes an ebook, an actual book, any of those things. Start it as a kind of grocery list. I've also had luck, or I should say I've also heard from other people who have had luck by starting an ugly first draft as a letter. So instead of saying, instead of sitting down to write and facing that blank page, the only way to sort of slay that fear of the blank page is to, you know, just give yourself permission to write spectacularly badly, you know, to produce that ugly first draft, but also just to maybe give yourself a little bit of momentum. Start it like a letter. Start it like, dear mom or dear Gavin or dear, you know, a client who asked a question about something that I'm answering with this post or this ebook or whatever. Another great way to start the ugly first draft is to just dictate it. I have a friend who writes the first version of all of his blog posts when he's driving to his office in the car.
Oh, really?
He takes it into his phone and then he gets to the office and he just runs it through a transcription service and boom, there's his ugly first draft. So I think there's any number of ways that you can tackle that. My way is the grocery list, but I think there's so many ways that you can do it. The key, I think, is to just start, just start somewhere and just start making your points and then critically edit it. That's a step that a lot of people, I think, miss. And when I say edit, I don't mean for grammar. I mean for clarity. You know, are you making the points that you want to make? Are you making them as succinctly as possible? Are you writing with respect for what the audience needs from you? I talk about swapping places with your reader. So, you know, write as a writer, but then on the editing, swap places with your reader and try to think of things from their point of view.
I like that.
Does this actually make sense? Am I actually, it's so easy for us to get caught up in our own heads, you know, to stay locked there. But I think if you put a little distance between the ugly first draft and the editing piece of it, it can make it a lot easier on you.
I really like that because I'm going to grab my journal for today. Because the quote in today's journal was, looking at things from other people's point of view is practically the secret to success, which I've never really thought about editing stuff from the eyes of the consumer, the person reading it, which is a really cool, but different way to look at it.
Be talking to your customers and talking to your prospects and the people who you want to sell to or do sell to. Because the question then becomes, well, how do I know what their mindset is? And, you know, so it's sort of one big continuous loop, right? You can't really write without knowing who you're writing for. And you can't really know who you're writing for unless you have that constant back and forth.
Yeah, I love it. And one of the other things that I picked out from what you said there was the permission aspect. And I think for me, that was the biggest change in attitude when it came to writing was, like, I'd be stuck there with a blank canvas going, oh, I don't know what to write. But when you just give yourself permission to write something, knowing that you'll come back to it, then you it just is easier. It's like an attitude, a mindset shift rather than a technical how to write a great blog skill shift, if that makes sense.
Right, exactly. And, you know, there's no one way to write. You know, there's no one way to write, just like as I talk about this and everybody writes, just like there's no one way to raise a child or to, you know, roast a turkey at I was going to say Thanksgiving, but you don't celebrate Thanksgiving. So at a holiday, say. So there's no one way to do it. But, you know, there are ways to do it very badly. But I think we do get locked in this mindset of, you know, I'm not a writer. And part of what I wanted to do in Everybody Writes is to say, that's not true. We are all writers. You are a writer. There's no one way to do it. And however you do it is perfectly great. The world needs to hear from you. They need to hear about, you know, what value you bring to the world. And so how do we communicate that? That's really all it is.
Okay, so let's carry on that trend then. When it comes to writing, I feel like one of the, and this is something else I've experienced, but one of the reasons that a lot of small business owners maybe struggle with it is they try and put on this front of how they think they should write. And often that comes across as like very professional, corporate, jargony type language. So how do you get out of that professionalism bug? And how do you write from like the heart? Because like when I had speaking to Chris Brogan, and some of his blog posts start with like, I'm 30,000 feet in the air. I've just been for a pee and I'm washing my hands, but my hands are still a little bit wet, but I'm starting this blog post. That is, I mean, that's just an amazing insight into Chris Brogan. But how do you get out of that like kind of corporate and towards your actual, how you speak to a friend? Like, is it a bravery thing? Does it come with experience?
Yeah, I mean, yes, and yes, and yes. And first of all, that is, you are absolutely spot on. That is so Chris Brogan, and that's why we love him. Right? I think there's a couple ways to do that. And first of all, let me just like back up a little bit and say that I completely empathize with that. You know, when I started my career, I started as a journalist and I wrote that way. You know, I wrote very hands up because that's what, you know, journalists are trained to take themselves out of the story. So it's been an evolution for me to understand that, you know, I am like to put yourself back in the story. So in terms of how do you approach that, I think there's a difference between being personal and personalizing something. And so I lean toward, you know, the personalizing thing. I want people to know when they're in the midst of reading something, whether they've noticed that it has my name in the from line or whether they've noticed my byline, that they know it's from me. Like, I want my voice to really be clear. And Chris is very much the same way. Like, when I read something of his, even if I were to block out, you know, Chris's name, I would know that this is Chris Brogan. It just sounds like him. Yeah. And so I think that that does come with practice. And that's why I think it's important to write every day, to sort of try to build that writing muscle that you have, because really what that means is you tap into your voice and you become more confident and you become more capable, and not from a technical standpoint, but really just from a confidence standpoint. I think it's scary to put yourself out there, and that's why we get into this whole, you know, dear customers, you know, those of us at Content Corp are excited to discuss our latest innovation. Like, no one cares. Yes. And, you know, I think that's actually the great thing about social media. I think it's a great thing about the internet just more generally, but especially social media, that it has opened up this line of communication between us as businesses, as individuals, and our customers. And so I think, you know, your customers want that. I think we all need to shed that marketing voice and, you know, write as a person. So in terms of how do you do that? I mean, as I said, I think it comes down to practicing, number one, so that you do gain the confidence to be that way. And just, you know, not being too afraid of putting yourself out there. To me, there is a difference between being personal and being and personalizing. And the only reason why I make that distinction is because sometimes if you go a little too deep into the personal part of it, it becomes less relevant for your audience. So I would say, go back to what we talked about a second ago. And make sure that when you do, you know, swap places with your reader, that it actually is, it still has value for them, because that's always what your goal is, to provide value to whoever it is that you're communicating with.
Yeah. So it doesn't just become a case of you writing like you would speak in the pub after a few pints of beer.
Yeah. Yeah. There is a difference, I think, between writing and talking. You know, we get this writing advice a lot, just write the way you talk. And I think that's great for an ugly first draft. I think that's fantastic. But I do think that there's a difference between writing the way you talk and then ultimately publishing something that's of value, because I think, you know, like if you were to read a transcription of our conversation, there's a whole lot of wasted words in here, you know, I'm using words like, you know, and actually, and really, and you know, you are too. And so all of those words, if we were writing, we would scrap all those out. One more thing I'll say, and then I'll just let you move on. But when you asked about, you know, how do you actually create that more personal approach in your writing? One just super easy trick is after you've done your first draft and actually you've done your, after you've done your edit, read it out loud. And a lot of times what I'll do is I will read it out loud and I'll record it. Like I'll just like record it into something. When I play it back, that's when you can sort of hear, God, I sound like a robot, you know? And I think just doing that automatically will help you see the weak spots so that you're not writing like a marketer, you're not writing like a business or some edifice, you know, you're writing like a person.
That's great. I love that. Really practical tip, because I can totally imagine me writing a blog post about something, listening to it back and being like, oh my God, that sounds so bad. Which is great, because then you can, and that's the ugly first draft, then you can go and can go back and change it up.
Yes.
Amazing. Anne, I'm going to interrupt proceedings now. It's time to play one of my favorite games. The game is called the 5-second rule. Have you heard of it or played it before?
I have not.
Okay, the rules are simple. I've got 10 different cards here. Each has a statement on it, completely random. I have no idea what they are. And I'm going to read that statement out. It might be something like, name 3 types of vegetable. And you have 5 seconds to give me your answer.
Oh, God. All right.
If you get it right.
I'm feeling stressed already.
This game has caused many of an argument within the Bell household. Get my stopwatch. You got 5 seconds. If you get it right, you get a point. If you don't, then you don't get a point. And you are competing against all your fellow guests. Are you ready? Oh, I actually have one question to ask you first.
I did not actually say yes, but okay, go.
This isn't part of the scoring. Would you like to go yellow cards or red cards? The yellow cards are slightly harder.
Are you kidding? Red. I don't work well under pressure. When I was in middle school, I got a comment on my report card that said, tries hard but works slowly. And I literally thought that, oh my God, am I impaired in some way? Like, is this an actual problem that I have? And I have since just learned to embrace it. I do work slowly. So it's who I am. So
I love it. Well,
I'm just using that as a complete disclaimer that I'm going to be the worst scoring person on this game.
I don't know. We've had some pretty low scores so far. Yeah. So let's see how you go. One thing I would say is some of the answers to these questions that you could just say them and I wouldn't even know whether they're right or not.
Oh, really? Okay.
It's like, name 3 of your neighbors and you could just be like Pat, Ben, and Sue.
And I'd be like, oh, okay.
So let's go.
Okay.
First question, name 3 things you wouldn't tell your parents.
Oh, man. I wouldn't tell my parents. Let's see.
Time is out.
Oh, that was it?
That's it. You got 5 seconds for each one.
Are you kidding? All right, can that be the practice?
Right. Okay, I'm feeling nice. I'm feeling okay. Nice.
Yay! Don't repeat the question.
One thing I would say again as well is that it doesn't necessarily, in that case, it doesn't need to be your parents. It could just be anything. Like, Mum, I got drunk. Does that make sense?
Oh, okay. Yeah. I mean, like, you know what the thing is? I'm overthinking this, aren't I? Okay.
Yeah. Just go. Whatever comes to the head.
Okay.
Let's do this. We're ready to rock and roll.
We're ready.
Anne Hanley 2.0. Name 3 Army ranks.
Navy, Marines, Army.
I don't know if they're ranks, but I'm going to give you it because I don't know.
Oh, not branches, but ranks. Oh.
Corporal, I don't know.
Lieutenant, Captain.
I'm going to give you that point because I'm feeling nice. Yes. Name 3 tall buildings or structures.
Empire State Building. International Place.
Time is out. Name 3 types of holiday.
Christmas, Thanksgiving, Easter.
Nice. Name 3 things you might put on a snowman.
Oh, carrots, coal, twigs.
Nice. So you're on a roll now. Name 3 types of nut.
Almonds, cashews, walnuts.
Nice. Name 3 dishes with eggs in the ingredients.
Frittata, omelet, hard-boiled eggs.
They definitely have eggs in them. Name 3 Beatles songs.
Oh, All You Need Is Love, Help, Eleanor Rigby.
Straight in there. Well, you had 1 second to go. You did it. And I'm trying to reset the time. Name three lakes or lochs in the UK.
Oh boy. Yeah, that's, I got nothing. I don't know, the English Channel? No, that's not even a lake.
No, that's, I'm not even going to say what that is because I'll get it wrong. And
I should have just made three up.
You should have, because I wouldn't have got them. Name three ways to injure yourself.
Oh, kitchen knives, chainsaws, falling off a ladder.
Nice. And final one, name three snacks made with chocolate.
Chocolate covered almonds, chocolate covered potato chips, and
yeah,
those are long answers.
Anne Handley, you scored 7 out of 10.
Whoa, no kidding.
Yeah, that's great.
That was with a few cheats, so that's good.
That's a good score. Well done.
Who's gotten the highest so far? Oh, one person you said got 10 out of 10.
Yeah,
but they probably didn't get that lake question.
No, I mean, you can get some easy ones, you can get some hard ones. So I think you had a good fair mix there of easy and hard.
Okay.
Amazing. Good job.
That was fun.
Yeah. I'd like to dive into Anne Handley a little bit now and move away from the writing side of things.
Okay.
One of the things I think when I see you is you must be incredibly busy with running marketing profs, traveling around the world speaking, finding time to write. How do you structure your time? What does a day for Anne Handley look like?
I start every day by writing. I write longhand in a journal. I think you do something very similar. So before I look at my phone, before I open my laptop, before I do anything, that's what I do. And the reason why I do that is because I find it very grounding. Mm-hmm. My day will get hijacked as soon as I open up my phone, as soon as I open up my laptop. And so I need that moment just to center and just to give myself those few minutes to kind of start my day.
Is that like a kind of inward thing for like self-development, or is that writing for say like a blog post?
Both. Typically what I do is I don't really write about my feelings or, you know, what I'm doing. What I typically will do is write about write stories, things that happened to me the day before that I think are either interesting or funny or ridiculous. Like, for example, this morning I just came back from a trip to Vegas and my driver was such a character. And so I wrote about him because in that 10-minute drive to the airport, I got a soliloquy about his life. And his parents were Scottish. And so he told me this whole story about during World War II, how his mom was put on a ship to come over here. She ended up being pulled off the ship because apparently there wasn't enough room on it. That first ship was sunk by the Germans. I mean, it went on and on and on from there. Yeah, it was very dramatic, but it was very interesting. And then at the end, he said, I made a comment to him like, you know, thanks for driving me. And he said, I love driving. I just love the quiet. And it was such a funny comment because he literally had been talking the entire time and, you know, super funny guy, really interesting. We had a great conversation. So I wrote about him because I don't know, at some point I might use that. There could be an analogy in there somewhere, but that's the kind of thing that I write down.
Amazing. So it's almost just like for fun. You might use it for work, but more of a fun thing.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, everything that I do is for fun, I guess. Like, I don't think of work is not fun. So I might find a use for it at some point, but more than anything, it's just a way to ground me and also a way to flex my muscle, you know, to just continually practice. For a long time, I should say, so on January 20th, 2018, I decided I was going to write in a journal every single day and I wasn't going to break the chain. I just decided that. I had tried over time since I was, I don't know, 8 years old to keep a diary, to keep a journal. I should be doing this. I want to be a writer. I should do this. And I always found it so boring. And then it wasn't until a year ago, and there's nothing significant about that date aside from the fact that something switched in my head and I said, I just want to do this. I just think there's something here. I've always wanted to do it. I'm just going to make a commitment. I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it for 90 days. And then I said, I'm going to do it for 120 days. And then I was like, I'm going to do 150 days. And I just kept pushing the goalpost further and further and further. And now here it is over a year, and I'm just in it. I'm just committed. And it's just changed the way that I start my day. It changes the way that I go about my day, because even as I'm talking to you now, I'm thinking, like, somewhere in the back of my head, you know, is there something I could write about tomorrow? Is there some interaction that we just had? Like my anxiety about that game, right? That kind of thing. And you're like handling of it. I mean, I don't know. So does that have an application to a blog post or like in a business sense? Maybe, maybe not. I don't know. But I just think it's important to not necessarily have an agenda or an objective with everything that I'm doing all day long. I'm doing it because it makes me feel good and I like it and I see some value in it.
I love that, because I think that's something I'm maybe guilty of, which is almost making everything objective driven or goal driven, or like even if it's, oh, I can't wait for football tonight because it's going to help me relax for business and be ready to work tomorrow morning.
Yeah. I mean, I'm very much the same way. You know, there's hardly anything that I, like I said, I everything that I do aside from that basically has a business objective. I mean, I work all the time and that's because I like it. I want to. It's not because I feel like I have to in any sense, but still I, and maybe that's why I never really committed to a journal before. Cause I was always like, why, what's the point of this? Like, I remember being 8 years old and thinking, why, like trying to write a diary and thinking, this is so boring. Like, I don't want to do this. Who's going to want to read this someday? Again, like even then I'm thinking about the audience. Like, what? You're 8 years old. Relax. So, you know, that's always been the way that I've been wired. And so in a lot of ways it's freeing just to say there is this one thing in my life that doesn't have an objective or a goal tied to it. But the irony of that is that I've actually used a number of those pieces in my biweekly newsletter. You know, I've talked to, like, I've pulled from it and it has informed my business. And so, you know, I don't know. So I guess what I'm saying is that even though it's pure fun, it actually does have relevance for the rest of my life as well.
And I think that's great. And it's that fun thing that kind of leads me on to my next question, which was, whenever I've seen you speak on stage, which I think is 2 or 3 times, I always feel like you just have so much fun on stage and you make it a fun experience for the audience as well. It's not like some business speakers that you see, it can be quite dry. Is that for you, is that a natural thing, this kind of like fun business combo that you've got going on? Or have you, from a stage point of view, have you had to develop that over time? Has that been a confidence thing? Has it always been there?
Yeah, I think it's always been there, but I was always a little afraid to let it out. And over time, I've gotten, you know, I've been speaking for 10 years, something like that. So really not a long time. Not like I didn't start as early as you did, certainly. So it's only really been in the past 10 years that I've, you know, intentionally said yes to speaking gigs. I never sought the stage. I never wanted to be on stage. I have friends, we have friends who, you know, they were in theater in school. They are just, they're sort of that big personality, right? They just love a great stage, no matter whether it's, you know, a pulpit or, you know, a platform, like it doesn't matter. They're just that person. Yeah. That's not me. And so it took me a while to realize that, that A, I could do it, because I just never really identified as a speaker. I always identified as a writer. And then I realized these two things are not mutually exclusive. Like one can actually inform the other. And, you know, and I can have fun up there. I can let that out a little bit. I think especially, and this actually relates to our conversation about writing too. It was, you know, the idea that I had to put on a certain persona, that I needed to be this professional person and be like, hello, I'm Ann Hanley and welcome to my session on content marketing. I that's not fun. That's not fun for anybody. And so it took me a while to realize that I could be myself on stage and that actually not only helped me feel more comfortable on stage, but also helped the audience and helped the message resonate a whole lot more. And the more that I leaned into that, the more successful that, you know, I feel like I've become and the more fun I have as well, to use your word. The risk in that is that the more you become, the more you embody yourself and the more whole self you bring to stage, the more that some people are not going to like that. And some people are going to be like, God, she's so annoying. Like I literally got that as a comment on a session on I gave a talk a couple months ago And, you know, hundreds of comments, you know how you read the comments after any sort of speaking gig, and hundreds of comments were like, she's amazing, she's fantastic, so much fun, na na na. One person, my God, she's annoying. And, you know, that cut me. It cut
that
me.
Sticks.
Oh, yeah. God, yeah. And of course, that's the one you pay attention to. And so all that to say, the more you let yourself out, you know, the more vulnerable you are. And then you open yourself up to a criticism like that, really making it, it feels very personal to me, even though this person doesn't know me. And even though, you know, I should not pay attention to it, I know that intellectually, it still is tough, you know? So, so that's, you know, that's the downside of it, but I wouldn't trade it. I mean, it just, it goes with the job, you know, just like some people don't like my writing. Some people are not going to like me on stage, and that's okay. You know, move on.
Yeah. As our friend Marcus would say, you just have to let them go, mm-hmm. Let some people go. Anne, it has been an absolute pleasure having you on the show. Thank you so much for spending some time with us. Please let everybody know where they can find you, buy your books, all those amazing things.
Yeah, first of all, thank you so much for having me. This was, I'm honored to be here. So thanks for asking me to be with you. Let's see, if you want to follow me, you can follow me at annhanley.com. I have a newsletter that goes out every other Sunday morning. You can subscribe at annhanley.com/newsletter. And yeah, find me on Twitter at annhanley. I'm also at marketingprofs. And yes, I think just... that's all I have.
Go Google Anne Handley. She's you'll see everything there, but check out the newsletter, because it is it's one of those newsletters that you actually want to sign up to. And thank you so much for being here.
Thanks, Gavin.
Hey team, me again. And I just wanted to say thank you so much for watching the video version of the podcast. And I hope you took something away from that. Maybe a smile, maybe something of inspiration, or maybe an idea came to your mind. Be sure to drop me a comment and let me know what that thing was for you. Now, if you want to listen to more or watch more episodes of the podcast, you can do that here on YouTube or Facebook, or head over to Apple Podcasts or the podcasting platform of your choice. Just be sure to hit subscribe, leave us a little review and a 5-star rating, and I will love you forever. See you in the next episode.